Isaiah chapter 47, the verse that I wanted to look at for my sermon was in verse 10, where the Bible read, "For thou hast trusted in thy wickedness. Thou hast said, none seeth me. Thy wisdom and thy knowledge, it hath perverted thee. And thou hast said in thine heart, I am, and none else beside me." And I get the title of my sermon from this verse. My title of my sermon tonight is Perverted Knowledge. Perverted knowledge. We see in the Bible says that in the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge.
Amen.
But just because the beginning of knowledge starts with God and ends with God, doesn't mean that there's not a perverted knowledge, a fake knowledge, a knowledge that's not the knowledge that comes from God. And we see in Isaiah chapter 47 some people that had perverted the knowledge. And that knowledge draws them away from God and makes them say, look, I am, and there's none else beside me. That's an attribute that God gives to himself. He's saying, I'm God, there's none beside me.
That's right.
But when you think about the word knowledge, sometimes I think we lose the reality that knowledge is like truth. And the fact that there's only one true knowledge. There's only one truth. I mean, truth isn't in many forms. It isn't just, you know, all kinds of options. No, there's one truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. There's not multiple ways to heaven. There's not multiple truths that get you to heaven. There's not multiple, you know, people that gave their life that you can believe on to get you to heaven. No, there's only one. And it kind of same thing is with knowledge. There's only one thing that's right. There's only one thing. I think one of the best ways to illustrate this is in math class. When you go to math class, the teacher has, you know, hey, let's do simple math. 1 + 1 = what? Is there like multiple answers to that question? Can it be 3, 4, 5, 7, 8? No, it's just 2. Right? Simple answer. 1 + 1 = 2. And now if you took a test, you had, you know, 30, 40 students take the test, you might get 20, 30 answers. I mean, you could get a different answer, but there's only one that's right.
That's right.
There's only one that's the correct answer. The same is with knowledge. There's only one thing that's right. There's only one knowledge that's true. And even in our world today, you know, if you take tests, especially when I took tests, I hated this question. There'd be a multiple choice question, and it would say, choose the most correct answer. Yeah, they would say, well, just choose the one that fits the best. You know, so you kind of look and you say, well, this one kind of fits, this one kind of... That's kind of how the world looks at everything today. They don't like black and white. They don't like heaven or hell. They don't like God or Satan. They don't like right and wrong. They don't like good and evil. They want to pick the best option. Well, this one's just the most correct. You know, they don't want to go and say, well, this is right and this is wrong. They say there's a true knowledge and a perverted knowledge. But the Bible says it is clear there's only one way. There's only one truth. There's only one life. The world doesn't want to say that there's actually a real answer. That's the problem. You see, even Oprah in some interviews, she's saying, there can't just be one way. There's got to be multiple ways to God. There's got to be multiple ways to heaven. That's what people want to believe. And the same is with knowledge. The same is they want to say, well, everybody has their own knowledge and all these things. No, there's only one true knowledge, and it comes from God. And everything else is a perverted knowledge. It's a knowledge that puffeth itself against the Lord Jesus Christ. When it comes to the one truth and ways to heaven, look, Islam's a false way. Buddhism is a false way. Hinduism is a false way. Shinto is a false way. Pastafarianism is a false way. Atheism is false. Judaism. Even if you get outside of just all the big religions, even inside Christianity, we see a lot of, you know, knowledges. We see a lot of options, a lot of solutions. Mormonism, Roman Catholicism, Protestantism, Calvinists, Arminians, Seventh-day Adventists, they're all false. They're all wrong. They all have a perverted knowledge.
Right.
So you think about them, they teach doctrines, they teach many things, they have a lot of knowledge, but is it the knowledge of the Lord? Is it the knowledge of the Bible? Is it the knowledge to be saved? No, it's a perverted knowledge. So there's only true knowledge and then perverted knowledge. And you go to the university today and you can gain a lot of knowledge. You can gain a lot of information, but is it good information? You can get a master's degree, you can get a doctoral degree, but guess what? It's in perverted knowledge. You might as well say, hey, I have a master's degree in perverted knowledge. That's about as good as most of the university degrees today. You know, when I was going back to school, I got a bachelor's degree, and then I was working at a bank. And I decided, well, I didn't really like my job. I was kind of thinking about doing something different potentially. I wanted something that was more career-oriented. I could make more money potentially. So I was like, well, I'll go back to school. And I started getting a master's degree in finance and economics. Now, I didn't really have a lot of interest in economics, but it was just kind of part of the package. It was just, you know, finance and economics. So I started taking the classes, and I got A's in my classes. I did really well. I was one of the top students, but I hated it. And I hated economics, because if you actually study economics, you're studying failed models. Every single thing in economics is just the most correct. It's just the best solution available. You're just studying, hey, well, this model of loss of supply and demand, it usually works, but not always. Hey, let's study the Keynesian theories. Let's study the theories of Milton Friedman. Well, they're good, but they don't always work. They work for, you know, big countries, or these models work for small countries, but they don't work for the whole world. You're just failing a bunch of false models. Models that only work sometimes, or work a little bit. But they don't ever have a true, you know, this just always works. This is just always true. You're just always studying something, just man's ideas of how the world works. And if you look up the definition of economics, the dictionary definition says, the branch of knowledge concerned with the production, consumption, and transfer of wealth. So the whole study of economics is what? To get money. They want to get money from somebody else into their bank account. They want to take other people's money that's already been distributed and start distributing it into their bank account. But the Bible says in 1 Timothy 6, for the love of money is the root of all evil, which while some coveted after, they have erred from the faith and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. I got a lot of knowledge in that class and in these classes and these studies, how to make money, how to take money from other people. But guess what? That's not true knowledge. That's not the knowledge from God. That's a perverted knowledge. Right. And I could get a master's degree and say, hey, I'm a master at taking money, but that's not godly. That's not what I want in my life. That's not what God wants for us, is to study all the ways of the heathen and how to covet money and how to desire money and steal it from people, because that's how they do it. But it's a perverted knowledge that would chase after money. Go to Matthew chapter 6, if you would. And when I was looking at, you know, probably the most lifted up economist is Milton Friedman. And you say, well, what was this guy like? You know, what did he say? Well, I found an interview where someone was talking to him, and he said, one thing I haven't heard you talk much about is faith. Describe your own faith. Your faith in God or your faith in people. Milton Friedman answered, well, faith in people and faith in basic principles of human freedom are very important, but faith in God is not. I would describe myself as an agnostic. And now, of course, those that are going to chase money, they're going to chase all the things of this world, many times they hate God. They don't want anything to do with God, for the love of money is the root of all evil. And we see Milton Friedman, I don't want to go to school and learn some agnostic's principles on life. Study all his knowledge. Study all the things he has, because the beginning of knowledge comes from the fear of the Lord. It comes from the Bible. I can't know anything unless it comes from this book. The only knowledge I can get is a perverted knowledge, is a false knowledge, is something that's crooked, something that's not right. If I go to school and I learn, hey, 1 + 1 = 3, how much is that going to benefit me? If I say, hey, 1 + 1 = 5, how much is that going to benefit me? I can study that for all my life, and it's never going to benefit me. And if I study economics at the university, and I get a master's degree, I get a doctoral degree, it's never going to benefit me in eternity. It's never going to benefit me. That's perverted knowledge. I don't want perverted knowledge. I only want true knowledge, which comes from God. That's why when it comes to the Christian life, we should only use this to decide if anything is true. I have some knowledge. I'm going to line up with the Bible to see if that's true. Hey, should I be concerning myself with transferring wealth to myself? Be concerned with money? Well, go to the Bible. It says the love of money is the root of all evil. Sounds like I shouldn't. Sounds like I shouldn't concern myself with that. But we need to go back to the Bible to see what's true, to have good knowledge. The Bible says in Matthew 6, verse 31, therefore take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Now in economics, what are they trying to study? They're trying to understudy how to get money into the government. So why? They can have food, so they can have clothing, so they can have goods. But the Bible's saying, hey, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. Right. If you want to study God's economics, it's just seek first the kingdom of God. Amen. We shouldn't be concerning ourselves with how to steal money from the poor and supply and demand and all these products. No, that's perverted knowledge.
Right.
Because God can take all those things away from you.
Right.
They don't tell you in these economic models how, well, every once in a while there's an external factor that comes and just screws up our model. It's like, hey, I had this perfect business model. I had this perfect product. But then guess what? A hurricane came along and destroyed all our factories and we have nothing. Hey, now you don't have any food. Now you don't have any clothing. But if you seek first the kingdom of God, all these things will be added unto you.
Amen.
You can trust something that is true. Some true knowledge. The Bible says in Proverbs chapter 10, the wise in heart will receive commandments, but a prating fool shall fall. He that walketh uprightly walketh surely, but he that perverteth his ways shall be known. You know, and a lot of times these people, they have this perverted knowledge, they have these perverted ideas. They kind of keep them in secret. They don't tell everybody they're trying to take money from the poor and do all these things. But the Bible says no matter how much they conceal their ways, they'll be found out. They'll be known. God knows. And it kind of, I'll read from Isaiah 47. It said, our main chapter. You can keep a finger though, because we'll kind of turn back every once in a while. It said in verse 10, for thou hast trusted in thy wickedness, thou hast said, none seeth me. A lot of these people that have this perverted knowledge, that have this knowledge that lifts itself up against God, they say, hey, there's no judger. There's no God. There's nobody that's going to see what I'm doing in secret. That's why they chase money. That's why they chase all the sin, the wickedness of this world. Because they say, hey, nobody sees what I'm doing. But God sees. God sees everything. In Ecclesiastes 7, I'll read for you. Turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. In Ecclesiastes 7, the Bible says, lo, this only have I found, that God hath made man upright, but they have sought out many inventions. So you see, God's purpose for every person's life is to live upright. He made them upright, but then they sought out many inventions. They're seeking the perverted knowledge. They're seeking the wickedness that comes out of their own heart. So the title of my sermon is Perverted Knowledge. We need to know that knowledge should come from this book. And there's a lot of knowledge out there today that Christians sometimes are just ignorant of. Because they just don't know what the Bible says. So they just trust man. They just trust the world. They just trust, oh, this is what my parents did. And this is what their parents did. This is what their parents did. Hey, this is what my brother does. Hey, this is what my spouse does. This is what my kids do. They're just trusting in man. They don't even realize they've never consulted the Bible. But we see that the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. It's not just, you know, part of it or somewhere. No. If you want any knowledge, it starts with God. It starts with fearing God. So if you're not fearing God and not reading His Word and not getting His commandments, you're not going to have knowledge. You're going to be ignorant. You're going to trust on some kind of perverted knowledge. Now, how likely would you want to go to the bank and have the teller be trusting in 1 plus 1 equals 0? You say, hey, I want to get some money out of the bank. I got a dollar in my hand. I got a dollar in the bank. How much does it come out to? Zero. Like, oh, I don't want that. You don't want perverted knowledge. You don't want to lean on that. You don't want to trust in something that's wrong. But we see a lot of people trust in false knowledge and perverted knowledge because they don't know any better. Because they're never seeking God's word first. So I have 7 points. These just kind of came from my personal experience and things that I see that Christians struggle with. And then even just those that are atheists kind of struggle with when it comes to the knowledge of the Bible. Because we see in this one verse that these people are saying, I am and none else beside. They're saying, none seeth me. Kind of referring to the idea of some of these people could just be the fact that there is no God that's going to judge me. They're kind of against God. But the first way that there's a perverted knowledge in this world is salvation. I mean, if our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost. The Bible makes it clear that there's many that pervert the gospel of Christ. They preach another Jesus. So I had you turn in 1 Corinthians 2. Let's read a lot of this real quick. Verse 1, it says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you, save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. So we see the beginning of knowledge, just preach Jesus Christ. If you want people to know something, the most important thing to know is that Jesus Christ is crucified for your sins, so you can go to heaven. Because without heaven, nothing else matters. I mean, does it really matter if you follow all God's commandments, but you don't know Him as your Savior? No, you'll spend eternity in hell. You got to know that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and rose again so you can be saved and go to heaven.
Amen.
That's the beginning.
Amen.
That's just the beginning. That's the foundation.
That's right.
We got to get that right or there's nothing. Look at verse 5. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this world, nor the princes of this world that come to naught, but we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, even the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the world unto our glory, which none of the princes of this world knew, for had they known it, they would have not crucified the Lord of glory. So see, the people that crucified him, they didn't know. They didn't have the knowledge, so they did a bad thing. They had perverted knowledge. They thought that Jesus Christ was just a man, or a malefactor. They believed the testimony of the Jews, and they ended up crucifying the Lord of glory. But the Bible said, if they'd had the knowledge, if they'd had the true knowledge, they of course would have never crucified the Lord Jesus Christ. That's why we need to go out and preach the gospel, so people can know who the Lord is and get saved. Look at verse 11. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man, but the Spirit of God. We can't know God unless we're born again. You can't know anything of God. All the knowledge comes from God. We got to get it from Him. We got to get it from His Word. Amen. Look at verse 14. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. We see that you can't have any of the knowledge unless you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the beginning. The beginning is getting saved. The beginning is fearing God. Because if you don't fear God, then you don't fear the fact that you go to hell. You don't fear the fact that He'll judge you. You don't feel the fact that you sin against Him and there's a punishment. You got to fear God. And if you fear God that you're going to go to hell, you believe on His Son and you get saved. That's the beginning of knowledge. Go to Romans chapter 2. But we see it today. There's so many people that preach another gospel. They preach a false version. They don't preach the Lord Jesus Christ. They preach their testimony. They preach a perverted knowledge. Hey, I gave a bunch of sins in my life and I found Jesus and I'm saved. That's their testimony. That's their perverted knowledge of how to go to heaven. No, it's believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. His death, His burial, and His resurrection.
Amen.
That's my testimony. My testimony is His testimony. Because I don't have a testimony. I don't care how many sins I did or didn't. It doesn't matter. It's just Him. It's all He gets all the glory. In Luke chapter 1, the Bible said, I'll read for you, and thou child shalt be called the prophet of the highest, for thou shalt go before the face of the Lord to prepare His ways, to give knowledge of salvation unto His people by the remission of their sins. John the Baptist was supposed to give knowledge of salvation to people. That's what we're supposed to do. John the Baptist was the greatest man to ever walk on the face of the earth, born of a woman. You know, saving deity factor Jesus Christ. Why? Because He's giving knowledge of salvation. He was giving that knowledge. We need to seek the Bible to get the knowledge. Romans chapter 2, verse 20, the Bible says, an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of babes, which has the form of knowledge and of the truth in the law. So we see in the chapter 2, He's talking to the Jews. He's talking to those that have the law. And He says, look, y'all have a form of knowledge, but guess what? It's a perverted knowledge. You're teaching that men can justify themselves, that through the law they can be saved. But we know that's a false gospel, a false teaching. And if you sum it all up, every false religion, every false Christian church, it's basically justifying themselves. Yep. It's the fact that they have a form of knowledge. I mean, you come to them, they have answers, they'll show you stuff. I mean, it sounds good. It's a perverted knowledge. They're not going to the Bible. Look at Romans chapter 10. Go just a few chapters forward. Go to Romans 10 and look at verse 2. It says, for I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. So it's interesting how he kind of correlates that. He says, look, you have a form of knowledge, but guess what? They actually have no knowledge. Because if you had true knowledge, then you would tell people to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You would preach them the knowledge of salvation. Their perverted knowledge in the eyes of God is nothing. It's vain. It's vanity. It's 1 plus 1 equals 20 million. Doesn't make sense. It's false. No reason to even keep it in your mind. So the first way that I think is just the biggest way that people pervert knowledge is just the gospel. And we need to go to the Bible to get the gospel. The Bible says if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater.
Amen.
You know why I love preaching that verse? I tell people when I'm going out soul winning, I say, hey, this means it doesn't matter who came and preached you the gospel. It doesn't matter if I did it, or Brother McPhail did it, or Brother Kevin did it, or anybody. It just matters what the Bible says.
Right.
Because we're going to the Bible to get the knowledge. It's not from me, it's from God. That's how people get saved.
Right.
Yeah. But I think the second way, if you go to Mark chapter 5, I think a lot of people get this that come to our church and understand true salvation, that there's a lot of people perverting. There's a lot of people not seeking the Bible for salvation. But there's a lot of other ways that Christians don't seek the Bible for knowledge. They don't go to this for the beginning. They go somewhere else. And they don't consult the Bible. They're ignorant of the Bible. Look at Mark chapter 5, verse 25. The Bible says, "And a certain woman had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse." My second point where people don't consider the Bible and seek man is in the area of physicians, in the areas of medicine, in the areas of, you know, modern medicine especially in the West. They're not seeking God first. They're not seeking the Bible first. They're suffering many things of the physicians because they don't know any better. They don't know what the Bible says. Go to Isaiah 47, our main chapter. Flip back. I'll read for you in 2 Chronicles 16, the Bible says, "And Asa, in the 39th year of his reign, was diseased in his feet, until his disease was exceeding great. Yet in his disease, he sought not to the Lord, but to the physicians. Mm-hmm. And Asa slept with his fathers and died in the 140th year of his reign." So we'll see another negative mention of the fact that these people, they're not trusting God, they're trusting some doctor, they're trusting some man. And when you think of a physician, a lot of times people give them a lot of, you know, honor or a lot of respect. They say, "Hey, this guy's been going to school for a lot of years, he seems really intelligent, he has a lot of knowledge." But guess what? A lot of times that knowledge is perverted knowledge. It's a false knowledge. It's not a knowledge that lines up with the Bible. And I'm not saying that trusting in a doctor, going to doctors, is wicked or sinful or evil. I'm just saying we should consult the Bible first and then decide what the physician has to say. Or decide if should I even go to the physician. And we see there's even a lot of physicians today that in my mind, you should just never go to. You probably shouldn't even consult at all. But we'll get there. And look at verse 12 of Isaiah 47, our main chapter. It says, "Stand now with thine enchantments and with the multitude of thy sorceries, wherein thou hast labored from thy youth. If so, be they shall be able to profit. If so, be thou mayest prevail." We see that these people, they were trusting in their sorceries. They were trusting in their enchantments. And there's a lot of people today, they're trusting in their drugs. They're trusting in their surgeries. They're trusting in what man can do. They're not trusting in God. But go to Job chapter 13. I want to lay down a couple verses here. I'll read for you in Matthew chapter 9. Jesus said this. He said, "They that be whole need not a physician, but they that are sick." Now, I don't know why, even in my life, this verse just seems so common sense, but even I need to go back to the Bible and see what Jesus said. He's saying, look, why in the world are you going to the doctor when you're whole? Why in the world are you going to the doctor when you aren't sick? When there's nothing wrong with you? When you seem in health, when you seem natural, when you seem good? Because then you might just suffer many things of the physicians. But look at Job 13, verse 3. It says, "Surely I would speak to the Almighty, and I desire to reason with God. But ye are forgers of lies. Ye are all physicians of no value. Oh, that you would altogether hold your peace, and it should be your wisdom." There's a lot of physicians today that should just hold their peace. Because guess what? They're of no value. Now, of course, Job was talking to his friends. He was saying, look, you're trying to help me and encourage me. You're like physicians of no value. He's just likening them unto a group of people that the Bible says there's physicians out there that have no value. Why? Because their knowledge doesn't come from this book. Their knowledge comes from man. It's a perverted knowledge. Who am I talking about? I'm kind of being vague. I'm going to say, to me, it's the pediatricians. The pediatricians today are physicians of no value. Why? Well, if you know anything about physicians, and I would say it's 99% of the time. I mean, there's maybe a one-time case. If they're sick, if you need some help, go to a doctor. But most of the time, people are taking their healthy baby, their baby that's whole, to this physician to suffer many things of the pediatricians. And I actually printed out an article. It says, how much money do pediatricians really make from vaccines? Now, I'll tell this, you know, I've seen this from a lot of people. I've put a lot of research into this. But when me and my wife had our first child, we actually took him to one of the most recommended pediatricians in the area. And when we were there, we told him, you know, it was about, I can't remember, like 3 or 4 months was maybe when their first immunizations were supposed to happen. And we told the guy, hey, look, we really like you. We really like coming here. We'll come do the checkups. But we're not going to do immunizations. And they said, well, because you're not going to do the immunizations, we can't have you as a patient. You can't even come here. You can't even give us money. We can't even see you. So they just kicked us out, basically. I mean, you can't show up unless you're going to follow their routine. Well, you say, why? Like, why in the world, if you want to give these people money, are they not taking you in? Well, this article, it actually highlights the fact that there's a link. They found the Blue Cross Blue Shield Physician Incentive Program, where it tells and it outlines how much money providers get for their patients that are immunized. And it says that they get $400 for every child that's fully vaccinated. Wow. So they just get a bonus on top. Hey, if you have a child of your patients, you get an extra $400. So if you have 1,500 patients, it adds up real quick. I mean, they're saying on average, these people might have anywhere from 100 to 200 patients. That's an extra $40,000 to $80,000 a year that they're getting from this just bonus income. Now, of course, they blame it on the insurance. You go, well, our insurance doesn't want to cover you, so we'll just, you know, you can't be our patient anymore. Because they say that they have to retain 63% of all their patients have to be fully immunized or they don't get the bonus. So that's why. Hey, if you come to their clinic and you're not going to get fully immunized, they're not going to get their bonus check. And we already learned that the love of money is the root of all evil. And why do these pediatricians just want to inject all kinds of weird junk into babies that are whole? For money. That's the only reason they're doing it. It's not because they really studied it. It's not because they really understand that it's going to help them. It's not even because in my mind that they believe it. They just want to believe it because of money.
That's right.
I bet a lot of them are just wicked to the core. They're physicians of no value. And worse than that, they're not just no value, they're hurting people.
Right.
They're suffering people, you know, all kinds of diseases and all kinds of sufferings and afflictions. I mean, there's testimony after testimony of people that took their healthy, normal, whole baby into the physician. They gave them a bunch of immunizations, and now all of a sudden they can't walk. Now all of a sudden they can't talk. Now they're disabled. Now they die. Now they get a fever. Now they're in the hospital.
Yep.
And the pediatricians say, oh, well, there's a bunch of studies. We've realized it's inconclusive. I know that your baby was perfectly normal and natural and healthy, and as soon as we injected it, it started, like, dying. But that was just a coincidence. Why? Because they want the paycheck, and they don't even have any liability. All the liability falls in the insurance company. Why the insurance companies push it? Because the immunization companies, big pharma, they pay the insurance companies. It's just a big circle of money. Everybody's making all this money. And the government keeps pushing more vaccines and more immunizations. And you know what? Christians today, unfortunately, are not going to the Bible. They're not saying, hey, they that be whole need not a physician. They're taking their healthy baby into a doctor and let him just inject some junk into him. Inject animal blood, inject some kind of disease. Why in the world would you inject diseases into your child? And you know what? Me and my wife, we were ignorant with our first kid. Our first kid even got one of the immunizations. We didn't even know any better. And you know what? I think most of the time, 90-some percent of the time, your kid's going to be fine. God made us so strong, so healthy, that we can withstand a lot of evil. We can withstand a lot of bad. But I don't want to play, you know, Russian roulette with my kid's life, with my kid's health. I don't want to just take him to the doctor and hope, well, he'd probably be fine, but you never know. I mean, they that be whole need not a physician. End. That's all it settles for me. Jesus Christ said it. And I'm not saying that I'm trying to give you medical advice. Research it yourself. I promise you, if you research, you know, the immunizations and the vaccines, you'll find out who's telling the truth and who's not. But there's one thing that is true. There's never been a study where they took, you know, 100 kids that have been vaccinized and like 100 kids that weren't and just studied them to see what their healths were like and compared them. The CDC's never done that. They've only done studies where it's just, you know, a small sample of one or the other. They've never produced a real study. There's no data. You basically just have to take anecdotal data, or you have to take small sample sizes from both sides to just even get any kind of idea. But you can see very clearly if you research it, who's just giving you ad hominem attacks and who's actually trying to give you research and data and information. But you know, anecdotal evidence to me is not invalid. I mean, how many people buy things online? I mean, you go to Amazon, what do? You look at the reviews. Is that scientific? Is that some, you know, scientific study? No, it's anecdotal evidence. But of course, if you're looking at zero stars and everybody says this is junk, it's defective, it's broken, you're gonna be like, I'm not gonna buy that. Yeah. But of course, why wouldn't you take the same thing with, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of parents and say, hey, my kid was adversely affected by immunization. My kid, you know, is perfectly normal, and then they have all these afflictions because of vaccines. That doesn't mean nothing. That isn't something you just disregard. Of course, if you're a normal human, you'll pay attention to those things. But we need to seek first the Bible and let the Bible determine, hey, is this a good idea? Hey, should I even do this? Because the Bible has all knowledge. God gave us all the knowledge, all the information we need. We can go to the Bible and seek that first before we determine if anything that somebody else is telling us is right. If we trust on man, trust on the physicians. And you know, I think there's plenty of doctors out there that love people, that want to help people, that are good people, that are just ignorant. But that doesn't give you an excuse to just follow. Don't follow a multitude of evil. Good intentions pave the way to hell. Go to Genesis chapter 18. We're going to have to speed up. Give a few things. Actually, go in another place. Go to Psalms 103. Because, you know, when it comes to medicine, when it comes to health and all these kind of things, a lot of people, when they go to a job, one of the big factors in getting a job is the benefit package. You know, the benefits. What are the benefits? What kind of insurance do I get? What kind of doctors? Well, let's see, the Bible even talks about that. Psalms 103, look at verse 1. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgiveth all thine iniquities, who healeth all thy diseases. I want to get a God's benefit plan who heals all my diseases. I don't care about what man's benefit plan is. I want God's benefit plan. And it comes from his knowledge. You know, you got to follow his laws, his rules. That's how you get the true knowledge. Go to Genesis chapter 18. Here's another area that people don't trust the Bible. They trust man. It's food. We see today, there's so many hot and trendy diets. The diets change every week. Sometimes, hey, it's good to eat meat. No, don't eat meat. Hey, drink milk. Don't drink milk. Drink water. Don't drink water. I mean, it's just all over the board. You say, well, how do I know? There's this scientific study, and they're proving these guys wrong, and there's this scientific study over here proving these guys wrong. How do I know? Should I be a vegetarian? Should I be a vegan? Should I do a no-carb diet? Should I do a paleo diet? I mean, what do I do? There's a lot of options. Why don't we just look to the Bible? Why don't we just see what the Bible has to say? Look at Genesis 18, verse 1. And the Lord appeared unto him in the plains of Mamre, and he sat at the tent door in the heat of the day. So we see the Lord. This is the Lord Jesus Christ, I believe, in the Old Testament, coming unto Abraham. Look at verse 8. This is talking about Abraham, and he took butter and milk and the calf which he had dressed and set it before them, and he stood by them under the tree, and they did eat. Now, I'm not going to focus on the diet. I'm just going to focus on what the Bible says are good things to eat. If the Lord Jesus Christ can eat butter and milk and the calf, I think I can eat butter and milk and the calf. And if you take, you know, dairy products and you take meat, you're going to eliminate a lot of these stupid diets. And yeah, that's what they are. They're stupid. Amen. Because they haven't consulted God's word. They're perverted knowledge. Now, of course, you can screw up anything. I mean, you can taint meat, you can taint butter, you can taint milk. But when it comes to good whole raw milk or good butter or good cow meat, you know, grass-fed beef, that's good because the Lord Jesus Christ ate it. Go to Exodus chapter 12, just one more book in your Bible. I'll read for you in Deuteronomy chapter 27. And thou shalt write upon them all the words of this law when thou art passed over, that thou mayest go into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, a land that floweth with milk and honey, as the Lord God of thy fathers hath promised. God promised the Israelites a land flowing with milk and honey. Now, would God promise you something terrible? Would he say, hey, we're just going to feed you a bunch of garbage in the promised land? No, I think milk and honey sound like they're probably good things to eat, good things to consume. Look at Exodus 12, verse 8. And they shall eat the flesh in that night, roast with fire and unleavened bread, and with bitter herbs they shall eat it. Eat not of it raw, nor sodden at all with water, but roast with fire, his head with his legs, and with the pertinence thereof. And ye shall let nothing of it remain until the morning, and that which remaineth of it until the morning ye shall burn with fire. And thus shall ye eat it, with your loins girded, your shoes on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and ye shall eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. Now, to be a part of God's people, to be of the tribe of Israel, you had to eat the Passover every single year. And guess what? It had meat. So you can't be a vegetarian or a vegan and live in God's, chosen people. You can't be part of the chosen people because you have to eat the meat. So you see, hey, I'm not going to subscribe to some diet that says meat's bad. It says you can't eat any meat, you can't eat any milk, can't eat any butter. I mean, the vegans got it all wrong. And I'm not saying it's wrong to eat vegetables or something. I'm not saying all the things that you shouldn't do. I'm just saying, look, don't tell me it's wrong to eat butter or milk or honey or the calf if God said it was good. If God said it was part of the promised land. Go to Matthew chapter 6. The Bible said in Isaiah 7, "Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." That's a verse a lot of people know. Talking about Jesus Christ in the future, they called his name Emmanuel. But the next verse says this, "Butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good." It even says Jesus ate butter and he ate honey. I mean, even in the Old Testament, if you don't think that was Jesus, hey, in the New Testament he ate butter and honey. Don't tell me that you shouldn't eat butter and honey. Matthew chapter 6, verse 11, "Give us this day our daily bread." Man, there's a lot of people attacking carbs today. Jesus said, "Give it to me every day."
Amen.
Mark chapter 9 says, "Salt is good." There's a lot of people that don't like salt. And of course, the Bible's a spiritual book. Of course, there's a spiritual application to everything. But God's not going to use a bad carnal example for something that's a spiritual truth. God's not going to say, "Hey, eat garbage because you're going to have everlasting life." I mean, that doesn't make any sense. Of course not. "Give us this day our daily bread." And you know what all the food things I think have in common? They're all talking about the Word of God. I mean, "Give us this day our daily bread." It's the bread of life. It's the Word of God. We got to, you know, the sincere babes, you know, desire the milk of the Word. We see the honeys referred to the Bible. I mean, all the food's basically talking about the Bible.
That's good.
You know, if you don't get a good spiritual diet either, which is what? Those that get the devotional books. Those that just read something online, the perverted versions, you know, the GMO food. Hey, you got to get the real thing, the King James Bible.
Right.
But don't tell me that it's bad. Don't tell me bread's bad. Don't tell me milk's bad. Don't tell me the calf's bad. I'm not going to chase your diet. I'm going to chase the knowledge of God. I'm not going to chase perverted knowledge. Go to Romans chapter 7. So not only do we see them perverting salvation, you know, they're perverted in their knowledge about physicians. They're perverted in their knowledge about food. But, you know, they're perverted in their knowledge about morals. Because basically, if you don't believe of God's law, if you don't believe in His Word, what is morality? I mean, what is right and wrong? If you don't have an answer, if 1 plus 1 doesn't equal 2, then what does? Nothing equals anything. I mean, nothing makes any sense. So that's why they don't have any morals. I looked at some guy studied this. He'd been like an atheist and then became a Christian. Said he's a Baptist. I don't know if he's saved or not. But he studied, you know, atheism, and he studied a lot of countries where their leader was atheist. And he said this. He said there was 28 countries in world history that can be confirmed to have been ruled by regimes of avowed atheists. These 28 historical regimes have been ruled by 89 atheists, of whom more than half have engaged in democidal acts of the sort committed by Stalin and Mao. Democidal acts is just meaning the fact that they were killing their own people. That they were purposely killing the people of their own democracy or country or government. It says that the total body count for the 90 years between 1917 and 2007 is approximately 148 million people. It says that the hands of 52 atheists. Says three times more people that were killed in human beings killed by war, the Civil War, and individual crime in the entire 20th century combined. So you see, more people are actually dying at the hands of these atheist regimes than all other crime, all other war, all other civil war. Why? Because when you don't have any morality, who's to say thou shalt not kill? We see they have a perverted knowledge. They have a knowledge where they just make up their own morality, where it's just a continual shifting sand. How'd you turn to Romans 7? Look at verse 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. The only reason we know anything's right or wrong is because it came from this book. That's the only way. The only knowledge of right and wrong came from God, came from His Word. Because without God, there is no right and wrong. There is no morality. Right. That's why it's perverted knowledge. Because when they start without God, when they say, hey, I'm going to make a law, and it's not going to come from this book, guess what? It's perverted. They can't make it. It doesn't make any sense. It doesn't have any foundation. Mm-hmm. I had not known lust, except where the law told me, thou shalt not covet. Look at Genesis 3. Go back in your Bibles. It said in Galatians 3, wherefore the law is our schoolmaster to bring us unto Christ, that we might be justified by faith. The law as a schoolmaster teaches us that we're sinners. If we didn't realize we were sinners deserving to go to hell, why be saved? I mean, what are you being saved from? We've got to know the law to know that we're sinners. Genesis 3:5, the Bible says, "For God doth know in the day that ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." The only thing Adam and Eve really knew, and Eve was kind of mixed up, was not to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. That was it. That's the only thing they knew. All the other knowledge of good and evil, they're ignorant of. Because it only comes from this book. And once they sin, we see God gives more commandments and more commandments. And by the hand of Moses, he gives us the law. That we can know the good and evil. We can know what's right and wrong. We can know how to behave ourselves. And with more law, more sin. That's why the Bible said, "For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law." If God never gave us any laws, if he never gave us the commandments, there wouldn't be anything that was wrong. There wouldn't be sin. Sin wouldn't be imputed. That just means at least to God you realize you're doing something wrong, but he can't hold you guilty when he hasn't told you it's right or wrong. Mm-hmm. Now go to Isaiah 7. Proverbs 31, I'll say, "Who can find a virtuous woman, for her price is far above rubies? The heart of her husband doth safely trust in her, so that she have no need of spoil. She will do him good and not evil all the days of her life." How does a virtuous woman do good under her husband? Well, she's got to go to the Bible. She's got to go to Proverbs 31 and read what it says to know how to do good. But you know, there's a lot of women today that have a perverted knowledge of what it means to be good under her husband, of how it is to treat their husband, of what to do. But if you go to the Bible, if you go to the laws of God, the Bible says the woman's supposed to be subject under her husband. But if she doesn't know that, if she's not following what the Bible says, she's not going to do good under her husband. She's going to do evil because she's ignorant. She doesn't have the knowledge of God. We need to go to the Bible to get all knowledge for all areas of life. I'm just highlighting a few points. I can't preach all knowledge. I can't preach every single area of life. But we need to go to the Bible first to see, hey, what does the Bible say? What should I be doing? And if you want to know if you're doing good or evil, right or wrong, you got to go to the Bible and see, hey, is this right? Hey, is this wrong? That's the only determination for right and wrong. Mm-hmm. I had to turn to Isaiah 7. It says, "Butter and honey shall he eat," verse 15, "butter and honey shall he eat, that he may know to refuse the evil and choose the good." Talking about Jesus Christ ate the butter and the honey, what the Bible. He used the Bible to know what was good and what was wrong. How did Jesus Christ know what to do? From the Bible. He got the knowledge from God through the Bible, through God's Word. He is the Word. That's how he knew how to refuse the evil and to choose the good. You can't know how to choose, you know, good when you're not following God's Word. And guess what? Most of the world, the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. It's perverted. You're going to always just do the wrong thing. If you're not seeking the Bible, if you're not seeking His commandments, you're not going to be stumbling on the right path. You're going to be stumbling on a dark path. And the Bible makes it clear that we need to get His Word, butter and honey. You need to eat. You need to get the Bible so you can know what to do. I'll give you one example. The Bible says in Deuteronomy 23, "Thou shalt not lend upon usury to thy brother, usury of money, usury of victuals, usury of anything that is lent upon usury." If you just follow the wisdom of this world, you'll never know that charging interest is a sin, that it's wrong, that it's evil, that it's wicked. But if you consult the Word of God, if you get the knowledge of God, you can say, hey, that's a wicked sin. Hey, I shouldn't have anything to do with it. That's why I'm glad I got out of banking. I'm glad I got out of that wicked place. Because guess what? They loved money. They were chasing money. They were consumed with money. Everybody there, all they could talk about is their net worth and their balance sheet and their portfolio and their investments and how much money they made and their bonus. Why? Because when you're surrounded with money, when you're just collecting interest off other people, which the Bible says not working hard, you're just collecting money off of money, that's wicked. That's a sin. But you never know that's even wrong if you never consult the Bible. Right. Hey, you say, what job should I have? Well, you shouldn't be charging interest for a living. I mean, that's not a right thing to do. You know, I was in that situation, and I found another job. I found another opportunity. But guess what? Seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. I'm not going to trust in man. I'm not going to trust in Milton Friedman's economics. No, I'm going to trust in God's economics. I'm going to get his benefit package. That's the career I'm going to have. Man. Go to James chapter 1. Look at my fifth point. The fifth way that I think a lot of people pervert the knowledge of God is just religion. Which kind of falls, it's similar to morality, but it's a little bit different. It's how do you actually practice your faith? How do you practice the worship of God? James chapter 1, look at verse 27. "Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world." Look, the Bible talks positively about religion, but you know, a lot of people, a lot of atheists, They don't like religion. They hate religion. They say it's so bad, and it's blinding people, and these people are a bunch of sheeple, and they're just following all these things. No, the Bible talks good about religion. It says, hey, it's to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. It's to keep himself unspotted from the world. How are you going to do that? By following God's commandments, by looking at his commandments. You're going to be in the world if you don't know what the Bible says, if you don't have his knowledge. You know, the thing that's interesting to me, I was thinking about this, atheists should actually love religion. And you're like, what? Why should they love religion? Well, if there were no God, you know, take me in this folly. You know, just go with me in this little folly for a minute. If there were no God, then there's no repercussion for any of your actions. So it's truly what evolution says, the stronger will devour the weak. I mean, you know, it's just going to be a bloodbath. People are just going to go crazy and kill each other and rape and pillage and take money. I mean, why not? I mean, if there is no God, you only have a short time in this world, just live it up. Kill whoever, do whatever you want. But you know, religion actually creates boundaries in society. It actually keeps people in order. It keeps people doing things. So if the atheist has this private knowledge, it actually doesn't even benefit him to tell anybody else. Because if he tells everybody, if he convinces everybody that there is no God, then there's no morality, there's no way for him to succeed, there's no way for him to rig the system. It's actually no benefit to the atheist. Yeah. For anybody else to believe it. Because religion keeps everybody confined and controlled, and then he can just know, hey, the system's rigged, I'll do whatever I want. If I don't get caught, then it's great for me. Why not? If there's no God. But we see they just don't understand religion. Religion's the exact opposite. It's to, you know, give alms to the poor in secret. It's to pray, visit the fatherless and the widows, keep himself unspotted from the world. The Bible says in 1 Timothy 2, talking about Jesus, says, who will have all men to be saved and to come into the knowledge of the truth. There is a knowledge that's true, but you know what? Those that aren't saved don't have it. The atheist doesn't have it. The Catholic doesn't have it. The Buddhist, the Hindu, every one of them, they don't have the knowledge of the truth. So they don't like religion. The Bible says in John 4, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. You can't worship God. You see all these people bowing down to the cube in Islam? See the Roman Catholic bowing down to Mary, doing all these sacraments, doing all these things? Guess what? They can't please God because they're not doing it in truth. They don't have the knowledge of the truth, so they can't worship him. They're not actually worshiping him. They're worshiping a false God. Or they're just doing some vain repetition. Something that can't profit them anything because they don't have any knowledge. Go to Psalms chapter 127. My sixth point is that people pervert their knowledge. They don't seek the Bible first when it comes to their family and when it comes to childhood. When it comes to just consulting, hey, what should my family life be like? What should my, you know, how should I raise my children? How should I do these things? They'll seek all kinds of books and they'll say, I think this is the most common thing. People just consult what their parents did. They just say, hey, my parents did it this way, and their parents did it this way, and my brother did it this way. You know, they just kind of look at family, they just kind of look at the world, they look at society. They don't go back to the Bible and say, hey, is what they are doing right? Is that how I should live my life? Should it be us four no more? Well, look at Psalms 127, verse 5. The Bible says, happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies in his gate. The Bible says, guess what? It's actually blessed to have many children, to have multiple children, to have his quiver full of them. And you know what? I say this every single time. It's always true. I've never met an older person that didn't say they wish they hadn't had more children. Every single time they say, hey, I wish I'd had more kids. Hey, I wish I had another one. Wish I had another son. Wish I had another daughter. Wish I had twins. Wish I had, you know, all kinds of kids. They always say that. Every single time. And you know, young people need to get that in their heart and respect their elders and say, hey, if every single one of them says they wish they had more kids, I better get on God's plan and just be, you know, multiply. You know, be bountiful. Just have as many kids as God will bless me with, because they're always a blessing. But the wisdom of this world, the perverted knowledge says, how are you going to afford college? How are you going to afford all those kids? How are you going to spend time with them? How are you going to do this? Oh man, that's really hard. You know, you're not going to be happy as a wife home with a bunch of kids. No, happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. You want true happiness? Have a quiver full of children.
Amen.
You're not going to have it just sitting at home, you know, being bored, wondering what to do with your life. Go to Revelation 2. And it's also even childbearing. The Bible says in Proverbs 13, he that spareth his rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. The wisdom of this world says, don't spank your kids. Don't tell them no. And you know what? Even me going to the pediatrician, we found one that wasn't going to make us do immunizations. That was going to let us just go there and just check our baby. But you kept feeding us all this false doctrine. Like, hey, don't drink milk. Don't drink dairy products. Don't be negative to your children. Just always be positive. You know, just be uplifting. You know, I mean, it's just feeding all this garbage. It's a physician of no value. I don't want to have anything to do with it. I'm going to seek God's wisdom first, not wisdom of man. Revelation chapter 2, look at verse 20, is my last point. It says, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants, to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. Last point is whoredoms. This world's gone mad after whoredoms. Fornication, idolatry, adultery, you know, homosexuality, bestiality, all these sins. Why? Because they don't have the knowledge of God. They're letting someone else give them some kind of perverted knowledge, like the prophetess Jezebel, like the whore Jezebel, teaching everybody to commit fornication and do this lasciviousness and live in sin and wickedness. But if you seek God's word, it says flee fornication. It says to abstain from idolatry. We shouldn't have anything to do. Abstain from all appearance of evil. That's a great verse to get memorized, get it on your heart. 1 Thessalonians 5:22. Abstain from all appearance of evil. All of it. Get away from it. But guess what? In Jeremiah chapter 8, I'll read for you. It says, were they ashamed when they committed abomination? Nay, they were not at all ashamed, neither could they blush. Therefore shall they fall among them that fall, and in the time of their visitation they shall be cast down, saith the Lord. We see so many people in America today, they're not even ashamed of their fornication. They're not even ashamed of their adultery. They're not even ashamed of idolatry. They have no shame. Why? Because they have no knowledge of the truth. They have a perverted knowledge. They're not seeking the Bible. They're not seeking God. And they can't have the fear of the Lord without the Bible, without the law, without the laws of God. They're just ignorant. Ignorance is bliss. Well, it's a blissful way to go to hell. It's a blissful way to have the wrath of God upon you. Even a Christian who's saved and going to heaven, I don't want God's wrath for adultery and idolatry and fornication. We see so many Christians will commit these sins because they're ignorant of God's word. They're not considering His knowledge. Go to, I want to look at Proverbs 19. Go back to Proverbs. I'm going to read for you a couple places. So in conclusion, look, I can't preach every single way that there's perverted knowledge in this world. I mean, it's everywhere. There's more bad stuff than good. There's only one thing that's true. It's this book. Amen. You can go to the library and get a billion books. I mean, big books way bigger than this. And get a lot of perverted knowledge. Get a lot of false knowledge. And I'm not saying that you can't learn other things and you can't learn something that's profitable. But we should seek first the kingdom of God. We should seek this to say, hey, is that even wise? I mean, the Bible says I shouldn't even lend upon usury. So how much should I learn about usury? But you know, the Bible talks positive about other jobs. Talks positive about people that are farming and people that are, you know, sheep, you know, taking care of the flocks and people that are, like, Paul was a tent maker. There's all kinds of things in the Bible. Hey, if there's a job in the Bible that someone did that's beneficial, learn about it. I mean, what's wrong about learning, you know, knowledge that the Bible has? But seek first the Bible and say, hey, does this even make sense? Is this something I should even indulge in? It's not anything wrong to, you know, go to school or learn something, but most degrees are just worthless. And guess what? An economics degree is worthless. Right. Don't get it. It's foolish. It's stupid. But you know what? I think an accounting degree, something that deals with numbers, that's good. 1 + 1 = 2. Hey, there's a lot of math in the Bible that you can look at. God adds numbers.
Yep.
God makes sure things are total. God makes sure that things are done and proper. Hey, I think accounting is a decent thing to go get an education and learn. But the Bible doesn't have anything negative to say about that. So why don't we seek first the Bible and say, hey, does this even make sense? But 1 Corinthians 3 says, for the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For it is written, he taketh the wise in their own craftiness. Psalms 14 says, have the workers of iniquity no knowledge? It talks about the atheists. It talks about the reprobate. They have no knowledge. They don't know the knowledge of God. 2 Timothy talks about the false prophet saying, ever learning, never able to come into the knowledge of the truth. Look, the false prophets have no knowledge. They don't know the knowledge of the truth. They ever learn, they're learning something. What is it? Perverted knowledge. They're learning false things. Things that just don't profit. Psalms 119 says, teach me good judgment and knowledge, for I believe thy commandments. Proverbs 9 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. Proverbs 18 says, the heart of the prudent getteth knowledge, and in the ear of the wise seeketh knowledge. Proverbs 22 says, bow down thine ear, and hear the words of the wise, and apply thine heart unto my knowledge. Philippians 1:9 says, and this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. 2 Peter 3 says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever. Amen. Knowledge is important to God. He's saying, seek knowledge. Seek knowledge. Get knowledge. Knowledge is important. Seek the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Grow in knowledge. We should seek the knowledge, but it should come from this book first. Shouldn't come from man. Shouldn't come from the wisdom of this world. Look at Proverbs 19, verse 26. He that wasteth his father and chaseth away his mother is a son that causeth shame and bringeth reproach. Cease, my son, to hear the instruction that causeth to err from the words of knowledge. Look, he said, stop learning false knowledge. My son, cease to hear the instruction that causeth to err from the words of knowledge. Stop seeking man that's going to tell you to not listen to this Bible. Stop seeking the false knowledge of salvation. Stop seeking the false knowledge of the physicians. Stop seeking the false knowledge of food. Stop seeking the false knowledge of all these things. I mean, let me go back to my notes real quick. Of their morality, of their religion, of their family, of their child-rearing, we should seek first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, God, for your word. Thank you, God, that we can know we can actually rely on something. That we can go to the source of knowledge, the source of truth, that you can impart into us all wisdom and all knowledge if we'll seek you first. And that we can rely on you and your promises, not just for salvation, but for the whole Christian life. I pray that we'd all just cease from learning false, perverted knowledge and just seek the knowledge that comes from above, the knowledge of the truth, the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.